the utility analysis given by Marshall had an improvement. The improvement was made by J.R. Hicks, who wrote a book, Value and Capital. And various shortcomings of utility analysis were pointed out. You know that utility analysis assumed that utility can be measured. In fact, utility cannot be measured because there is no standard for measurement of utility. We simply say that first unit gives 10 utility, second unit gives decreasing marginal utility, which is 9, and marginal utility keeps on declining. At a satisfaction point, marginal utility is 0, and despite that, if a consumer continues consumption, then utility is negative. Now, what is 10? What is 9? What is 0? What is minus 1? It is not known to us because there is no standard measurement. We are simply indicating level of satisfaction on the basis of numbers which we assign, and these numbers were assigned on the basis of intensity of a particular unit of a commodity. Since utility cannot be measured, therefore this theory of indifference curve came into existence. And J.R. Hicks talked about a two commodity world, two commodity world, where it was assumed that there are two commodities in the country, and a consumer will buy some units of X and some units of Y. If we take some units of X and some units of Y, then this is called a combination of X and Y goods, X plus Y. According to this theory, an indifference curve has been defined in a very befitting manner. The definition given by J.K. Eastham is that an indifference curve is a locus of points. Now this is indifference curve. It may be IC1, IC2, IC3, but how we derive? We derive on the basis of definition. And what definition says, as per J.K. Eastham, that indifference curve is a locus of points. Locus means road. Locus of points, a road of points. In other words, on that road, there are number of points, and each point gives a combination of two goods. Supposing that it is point A. Now on point A, you get a combination of X and Y. Say here X are 5 and Y are 15. This means that A combination has 5X plus 15Y. Now you can get one such combination. But supposing a consumer has a changing mind and he says that he wants to change the combination. In other words, from 5x plus 15y, this is said to be one combination, then he can think of a second combination where he wants to change the quantity. Supposing he wants to increase x, say by 1x, or he wants 6x. Now another assumption was that income of a consumer is constant. If income is constant, then how a consumer can change one commodity without sacrificing another commodity? He already has 5x plus 15y. Supposing that with this combination he has already spent all his income. That is why J.R. Hicks told that it is a two commodity world, and whatever income a consumer has, he has already spent on it, but his requirements have changed. And if a consumer does not get units of X and Y as per his requirement, then he cannot maximize satisfaction. And indifference curve analysis is mainly for maximum satisfaction from limited resources. This is what managerial economics teaches, that every consumer has got limited resources, but a consumer has number of wants. Therefore, he has to give priority, and on the basis of that priority, he will reshuffle the contents of a combination, and on that basis, he can maximize his satisfaction. The ultimate aim of a consumer is to maximize satisfaction. Ultimate aim of a producer is to maximize production and profitability. Similarly, the ultimate aim of governments may be to maximize revenue and minimize the burden on people. With more expenditure, with more social satisfaction. This is how managerial economics comes to consumer analysis, where indifference curve analysis gives a technique to maximize satisfaction with minimum resources. Hence, if he wants to increase units of X, then since income is limited, therefore he will have to reduce the units of Y. Supposing for increasing 1X, he has to sacrifice say 3Y. So he had 15Y. Out of 15y, he will sacrifice 3y to get 1x. Therefore, now he has 12y left. This is a second combination. Now this sacrifice of 3y for 1x is called MRS, or marginal rate of substitution. This is called marginal rate of substitution. Or it is a sacrifice rate. It is very clear that if you want to increase commodity of one unit, you will have to decrease another commodity, or if you increase x, you decrease y, or you sacrifice y, and accordingly y has been sacrificed. Supposing now consumer says that he wants one more x. Now one more x means he wants 7x. Therefore, to obtain 1x, he will have to sacrifice. Now just remember that if you increase x, you already have satisfaction from x. If you take additional unit of x, then you will sacrifice, but sacrifice will be less. Sacrifice will not be same 1x is equal to 3y. Sacrifice will come down from 1. For 1x, it will now be 2y. Sacrifice or marginal rate of substitution always decline. This point must be kept in mind that marginal rate of substitution shall always decline. And therefore, if we deduct 2y, we have now 10y left. Therefore, we have another combination, 7x plus 10y. Similarly, we can think of one more combination. Say we want to increase one more x to 8. Now, sacrifice will not be 2x, 2y, but it will be 1y. Means 1x is equal to 1y. So, sacrifice is 1y, therefore, now remains 9y. Or another combination is 8x and 9y. Now, with limited income, a consumer can have, say, combination 1 or combination 2 or combination 3 or combination 4. He cannot have all the four combinations. Either first combination where 5 plus 15. This is the situation. And we may have 6 plus 12 or 7 plus 10, 8 plus 9. If we plot all these combinations on a diagram, we get this indifference curve. We derive IC1 as the indifference curve, which has been derived by this indifference schedule. This is called indifference schedule, which is constructed on the basis of a particular income level. Supposing income is say 5,000, with 5,000 we have developed this table, means we have one curve which is for the level of 5,000 income. As you know, income of consumers may keep on changing, and if income changes, then you will have to reconstruct an indifference schedule. Again, mind it that we have two commodity world. We can buy two commodities, but with a higher income. Now supposing income increases to 10,000. Therefore, whatever units we are taking here will be doubled. This indifference schedule is based on 5,000 income. Now income increases to 10,000. So we double the quantity. And if income increases to 15,000, then we will have triple the contents, triple quantity of these goods. Therefore, at 10,000, we get IC2. And 15,000 we get IC3. So this is based on 10,000 income. This is based on 15,000 income. So this is how we derive three indifference curves. And if we show three indifference curves on this diagram, then it is called indifference map. Indifference map contains various indifference curves of different level of satisfaction. As income rises, a consumer will shift to another indifference curve, and again with increase he will shift to a higher indifference curve. Therefore, indifference map contains different indifference curves of different level of satisfaction. Now I revert back to derivation of an indifference curve. I told you that we form these combinations, and if all these combinations are plotted here and we join these points, then we get an indifference curve. So we come back to definition that indifference curve is a locus of points. It is a locus of points representing various combinations of X and Y commodity. Say for example 1, 2, 3, 4. These are the combinations. It may be 5 plus 15 or it may be increased to 6. The moment we increase it to 6, the quantity will come down to 12. If we increase it to 7, automatically quantity comes down to 10. And if we increase it to 8 units, automatically Y will be reduced to 9. Therefore, we have these four points A, B, C and D. It means that indifference curve is a locus of four points, that is A, B, C and D. So it is a road of points, and every point represents a combination of two goods, either 5 plus 15 or 6 plus 12 or 7 plus 10 or 8 plus 9. So if we have these four combinations and we join them, then by joining these combinations A, B, C, D, we get an indifference curve. Now supposing that we have plotted these points, I remove the curve. I simply say that these are the combinations. So these are four combinations A, B, C and D. And if we join them, automatically we get an indifference curve. Therefore, it is proved that an indifference curve is a locus of points representing various combinations of two goods. And a consumer is allowed to select one combination because of the income limitation. So, for that particular one combination, he is indifferent. But although four combinations give similar level of satisfaction, either you take A combination or you take B combination or you take C combination or you take D combination, any one combination you select and you get the same satisfaction. Now I give you an option. Say these are four marker pens. All the four marker pens are same. I tell you to select one. What will be your answer? You will say that all four pens are same. And all these pens will give similar level of satisfaction. Therefore, you will be indifferent. You will say, sir, you give me any such pen because all pens are same. All combinations are same. Therefore, you will be indifferent. And if a curve is drawn on the basis of these combinations, then it will be called an indifference curve. So, a consumer is indifferent whether you tell him to take A or you take B or you take C or you take D. You take any such combination and you will be indifferent. Now a consumer gets maximum satisfaction. How he derives maximum satisfaction is to be seen here. And for maximum satisfaction, there are two conditions that we must know: income of a consumer, and second condition is that we must know the price of these two commodities. If we know the price, supposing income is 5,000 and price of X is 100 rupees. Similarly, price of Y is say 200 rupees. Income is 500. This is the price. Income is 5,000. So if income is 5,000 and price of these units X is 100 rupees, so maximum one can buy 50 units. If price of Y is 200 rupees and given the income, maximum one can buy is 25 units. This is the upper limit of quantity, which either 50x one can buy or 25y one can get. This is the maximum limit. If we mark these maximum limit on this diagram, then we know the maximum quantity. Say this is y axis, this is x axis. On y axis we can mark 25. Say this is 25. And 50x, supposing that this is 50x. The maximum quantity one can buy with given income of 5,000 and prices are also given. Therefore, 25 and 50 are joined. We get a line within which a consumer has to make consumption. This line, or we say AB line, AB line is called price line or budget line, or we call it income line. In other words, we can buy within the given income. We cannot buy beyond that. And this income line will change. If income changes, earlier I told you that income increases from 5,000 to 10,000. And from 10,000 it increases to 15,000. So we will change the indifference schedule. If income is say 15,000 or say 10,000, in that case, how much we can buy? So we can buy 100x or we can buy 55. If income increases to 15,000, again there will be a change in the pricing. Now with 15,000 we can now buy 150x or 75y. So we have three possibilities. Either we can have 25y and 50x, which I have already marked A to B. Then we have 50y and 100x. So 50y say comes to this place, and 100y, 100x comes to say here. Then the price line will change to CD. In other words, higher the income, higher the quantity, and price line will shift. Similarly, if there is a change in price, then again there will be a change in the price line. Here we may draw even say 75y or 150, again it will be on a higher point. So here we have 75 and here we will have 100. So price line shift. If income changes, price line will also shift. And here if say there is effect on price, supposing price of Y goes up to 400. Now within the given income, you will buy less. So here now you get say 10,000 is the income. In case of 10,000 income, now you are getting say 25 y. Earlier you were getting 50 y, now you are getting 25 y. So y will come down, but x will be the same. So price line will change like this. It should be very clear that whenever income changes, the price line will change. Similarly, whenever price changes, again that price line will shift, budget line will shift. Now where a consumer will get maximum satisfaction? This we have to find out. And for getting maximum satisfaction, we again draw a diagram that given the income level, we will have different incomes. And maximum satisfaction will be derived where a price line is tangent. Is tangent to indifference curve. It may be indifference curve number 1 or 2 or 3, wherever price line is tangent to indifference curve, that will be a point of maximum satisfaction. For example, on this diagram, there are 3 price lines or income lines. And on indifference map, we have different curves. Therefore, if this curve IC1 touches it or tangent on this point Q, therefore maximum satisfaction will lie on Q, and you may be getting OM of X plus OB of Y. If income increases, you go on the higher side. So you have another indifference curve. And on this particular indifference curve, wherever it is tangent, you will get an equilibrium point. Supposing that this indifference curve IC2 is tangent on point Q1, therefore a consumer will get maximum satisfaction on point Q1, and if you still go higher with higher incomes IC3, then Q2 will be another point of maximum satisfaction. These are the points of satisfaction. Now supposing your income is 10,000. On 10,000 income, Q1 is the satisfaction. At 10,000 income level, Q1 is the point of maximum satisfaction. Then question comes, why Q2 is not, or why Q is not a point of maximum satisfaction? Now we have already assumed that a higher curve gives higher level of satisfaction. Therefore, if 10,000 is the income at Q1, indifference curve is tangent to the price line. Therefore, maximum satisfaction lies on point Q1. Now here, at this income level, this is the limitation of a consumer that he cannot go to Q2. Because Q2 is situated on a higher curve, and if it is situated on a higher curve, then you must have higher income, but you do not have 15,000 income, your income is 10,000. If income is 10,000, at Q1 alone, indifference curve number 2 is tangent to the price line. Therefore, only on Q1 there will be maximum satisfaction. Similarly, Q is not a point of maximum satisfaction because on point Q, it is a lower curve. A lower curve will give a lower level of satisfaction. A higher curve gives higher level of satisfaction. Therefore, at a particular income level, you will have satisfaction, maximum satisfaction on point Q1, where price of a commodity is equal to the sacrifice which you are making, because on this point marginal rate of substitution is declining. At a declining rate, if you consume a particular commodity, then that will be a point of maximum satisfaction. Therefore, Q1 is known to be a point of maximum satisfaction. This is how indifference curve analysis can simply tell you that with given resources, you are getting maximum satisfaction or not. Here we are not saying that what is the utility, 10 or 9 or 8 or 7. We are simply saying that you get maximum satisfaction on Q, and with given more income, you get maximum satisfaction at Q1, and then you get maximum satisfaction on point Q2. We simply say that every higher curve gives a higher level of satisfaction. That means that if you are on Q1, you get a higher level of satisfaction as compared to Q. Means you are better off on IC2 as compared to IC1. You are better off on IC3 as compared to IC2 and IC1. We simply say that you are better off or worse off. If you go on a lower curve, you are worse off. If you go on a higher curve, you are better off. Therefore, we simply say that comparatively a consumer may be at a higher level of satisfaction or at a lower level of satisfaction, but we do not say exactly that satisfaction is how much more or how much less, because our study is based on human beings and human beings are subject to change. No law can predict the level of satisfaction. The reason is that we cannot measure satisfaction. It is a psychological phenomenon with the consumers, and therefore we cannot say that he is better off in this quantified form. We can simply say in a broad way that he has more satisfaction on IC2, less satisfaction on IC1, and a higher satisfaction on IC3, and one can reach any curve depending on the income level. We have already seen that income has changed. This changing income will give an income effect. If you go on a higher curve, you move to a higher equilibrium point, and if we join equilibrium point Q1, Q2, then we get another curve which is known as ICC, or income consumption curve. And this income consumption curve tells us that if income increases, consumption of both the goods X and Y will also increase. On the other hand, if income reduces, then the consumption of X and Y both will come down. That is why this is income consumption curve. Similarly, we can show price effect, where price of one commodity may change. So we have a price effect, or we may have a substitution effect. This is called a change in equilibrium of consumer. This is how indifference curve technique can measure the level of satisfaction. It can suggest how we should make changes in the combinations of two goods so that we derive maximum satisfaction on the given level of income, which may keep on changing. Thank you.